Can I have everyone's attention? I think we are ready to begin. So on your tables are pieces of paper. We're going to use those to write questions for the candidates, particularly the ones that are running opposed. I have two lovely assistants today, my board chair, Joanne Kinchla, and our newest member, Pat McDermott, who are going to collect those from you. We would really love some good, thoughtful questions from all of you. We have some exciting races, and I believe it's the first time we've had a moderator race, at least since I've been here. So I want to thank Rich Hosford from BCAT for moderating for us. Much appreciated. He is going to run the show from here with a little bit of help. He may ask Kevin Sullivan a couple of questions, but it won't be underhanded or anything. just format. So I will be timing. So when the candidates are speaking, if you would just kind of try to keep an eye on me, I'll raise my hand like an idiot and go like this when your time is up, and I'll try to give you a nod when you've got a couple of minutes, when you're getting close, within a couple seconds. And I think that's all I need to say. Thank you all for coming. And I'll say it before we start. Don't forget to vote next Saturday. Not this Saturday, next Saturday.
Stay playing.
If you all want to write your questions, and Joanne and Pat, if you want to go around and collect them, we are going to do Selectmen first. And then we will also have the we have their names, and we're going to have them draw to see who goes first.
We also ask that all the questions be worded in such a way that both candidates can answer them, so they're not leaning towards one candidate or the other. Officially kicked off now. So as Mark said, I'm Mitch Osford with BCAT, and would like to welcome you to this year's Council on Aging debate for the Burlington Town election. Thank you to all the candidates for coming today. We know it's not for the money, because if it was, you'd be getting paid pennies on the hour. In the Selectmen's race, we have three candidates for one seat. That means you will have one vote for this office. The same is true for Moderator and Recreation Commission. As we said, we're asking the audience for questions, and they must be worded so that all candidates can answer them fairly. If Marge and I decide the question is unfair or unacceptable, we will try to reword the question so that all candidates can answer it, or if necessary, we will have to eliminate the question. For the Board of Selectmen, where we'll be starting today, we have three candidates, two of which are here today. We have James Tigges, who is a member of the Board of Appeals and a former town meeting member. And we have Joan Kennedy Constant, a town meeting member. We also have Virginia Mooney in the race. She's not able to make it today. She is a town meeting member and a former member of the Board of Selectmen. As we just had the drawing, we're going to give each candidate a minute for an introduction. And we're going to start with Jim.
Thank you, Rich. First of all, thank you to the Council on Aging for hosting this event. My name is Jim Tigges, and I'm here as a candidate for Selectmen. I didn't just move here 2.5 years ago. I've been here for 50 years, and I plan on staying here. I love this town. Like many of you, I grew up in this town, and we've seen it change so much over the years. For example, Building 19, or I can even remember it as the IGA. So, Burlington is a great town, and many people wish they could live here. We're very lucky. Many of you have seen me here or at events around town, and you know I am committed to this town. I've been a PTO president, Rotary president, 10-year town meeting member, and I'm currently on the Board of Appeals. To me, running for selectmen is the next step. As a police officer, I've been entrusted to protect and serve the residents of this town, and many of you know I have been doing that honestly and faithfully for 30 years. Nothing will change. I will continue to be the same Jimmy Tiggis that many of you know, and I would be honored to serve as your next selectman. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Joan Kennedy Constant. I am a town meeting member from Precinct 7. I am on Ways and Means. My subcommittee is the school department budget. With regard to my background, I have been a practicing attorney for 26 years. I'm now in my 27th year. I work in the field of corrections. I started my job many, many years ago at the old Charles Street Jail, and I currently work for the Massachusetts Department of Correction. That is my day job. My husband and I were fortunate enough, after raising our children, we chose to move to Burlington after looking at several different communities. Burlington is a wonderful, wonderful place to live. And we just feel so fortunate to have moved here about 3 years ago. In terms of my activities in Burlington, I've immersed myself in this community. I'm so blessed to be able to work amongst so many pleasant people here. I work with people helping people. I'm in a civic organization that 4 or 5 times a year takes between 1,200 and 2,500 pounds of food from the Greater Boston Food Bank. We bring it back in our trucks and SUVs back to the Burlington Food Pantry to be stocked on the shelves. I also am a friend of Mary Cummings Park, so I work with several individuals to clear trails there. And I welcome the opportunity to be your next selectman.
All right, thank you very much. Well, now we're just going to quickly review some of the questions. We have a lot of inquiring minds here today. All right. Let's see, where do we want to start? All right, we'll start with a perennially topic of interest, traffic. Route 3A, otherwise known as Cambridge Street, has a lot of traffic. Are there any plans for a redesign, such as perhaps left-only exits leading into store and one only for through traffic? So a left turn only and one only signal for through traffic. Any idea, any thoughts on traffic signals and how to sort of fix Route 3A?
With regard to Route 3A, because it is controlled by... Oh, I'm fine on my feet. This is how I try cases, mostly on my feet. With regard to Route 3A and traffic, it obviously involves outside stakeholders. The town of Burlington itself alone cannot control that. That involves the Department of Transportation. And there's been different propositions with regard to lining the streets and such. And it requires actually not just the efforts of the selectmen themselves, but also it would be outside stakeholders, including State Rep. Ken Gordon, to be able to facilitate this. So I'm not quite sure if we could do left exits only, and I don't know if we can do the the straight line down. It would be wonderful, because we've all experienced it. When you're on Route 3A, it's an accordion. It's wide, and then it's narrow. It's wide, and then it's narrow. It can be nerve-wracking, needless to say. And obviously, there's more people that flow onto Route 3A because they're heading down towards Billrick and other neighborhoods, and it's very difficult from a corporate perspective. I think one thing we could do to mitigate traffic certainly is talk with our corporations here in town and ask them to consider something of, like, with regard to flex time. Many of the corporations that are here are multinational by nature. They are doing business in Austria and Singapore. It would make for happier workers and for happier residents here if we could partner with them to have them stagger their workers' arrival and departure from their offices. The workers aren't happy in the traffic any more than we are. So it's something with our future corporations to endeavor when they come to site their businesses here or locate here, and maybe reach out right now. And that's a simpler solution that's cost-effective, and we don't have to go through the state legislature because that's a sausage-making process.
Thank you. I'll start with a question that I get asked often. Is Cambridge Street one lane, two lane, three lanes, four lanes? My answer is all the above. Okay? Cambridge Street is owned and maintained by the Commonwealth of Mass, State Department of Transportation. Burlington has very little say in that. The state has given Burlington a $1.6 million grant to incorporate integrated traffic signal devices all the way from Skelton Lane down to Cambridge Street, up Mall Road, and along the turnpike from Wheeler Road to Terrace Hall Ave. All 27 signals now talk to each other. They work on thermal sensors. It will improve traffic on 3A. As far as widening, we saw what happened in Billerica when they made it one lane. What happened? Traffic went into the neighborhoods. Do we want that? Do we want the traffic in the neighborhoods? No. So Burlington's hands are tied as far as certain things, but there are things we can do. We can talk to the property owners, talk about curb cuts on private property. The used bookstore, there's six ways in, six ways out. That's six intersections. We don't need all six for that. So that's what I think we can do, is work with the private property holders, do as much as we can as Burlington people. And unfortunately, the state, I've heard no talk of left turn only, but the state, we're at their discretion. We really can't do too much because it's not ours. Thank you.
All right, next question about the senior center itself. In what way can you help seniors move their future building along? I'm sorry.
Where? I did not put that in there.
I don't know, is that Marge's handwriting?
Well, the answer says let's replace Marge first, but no. No, Marge does a wonderful job. She has a very small budget, relatively speaking, but the services she offers are second to none. I turned 55 last week, okay? This isn't just a campaign event. This is a scouting mission for me. I'm looking for the table where all the cool kids sit at, because I'm gonna be here soon. So I wanna make sure this place stays good and nice for when it's my time. So what I found with the Council on Aging, I found this with my own mother, who was in her 80s, is the residents don't know about it or they don't want to come here. They say, as my mother in her 80s said, that's for the old people. She was in her 80s, okay? I want, when this is renovated, I'd like to do maybe an open house or two, some events, draw people in. Once they see, and I've talked to people who said, I would never go there. Now that I'm there, I love it. So a recruitment mission, so to speak. Let's get more people here to use it. If you build it, they will come.
Fair enough. I came to the Council on Aging here to watch the presentation by John Petrin with regard to the renovations that are going to ensue in this building. I took copious notes. I do recall the first question from a woman about that table there, the second one down in the center row. Her first question was with regard to the elevators. There's only one elevator in this building, and according to the design that they have, they're not planning on putting a second one. Because her first question is, are we going to put in a second elevator? And I'm not 55, and I'm 53, and I got a fistful of vitamins. You know, I try to stay healthy. We all do. But for seniors that are coming here to utilize the Council on Aging building, I think her first question is an imperative one that needs better answers. What are we going to do? Are we going to put in a second elevator or not? The plans is currently configured, and what they're going to asked what they were opening bids for yesterday afternoon, according to John Petrin, was for one elevator. And I think right now, before we start talking about different flooring and colors of paints and where the storage is going to be in the back of the room here, we need to think more fundamentally, because a second elevator is probably advisable. John Petrin, to his credit, did promise that the elevator would be very, very speedy. But nonetheless, I think a second elevator for the seniors to be able to ambulate up to that second floor is imperative. I don't know. Maybe I'll love walking the stairs. I can do a few flights, and then I get a little tired myself, and I run a bit. So I think for the Council on Aging, I think it's time to renovate this place. John Petrin was quite honest in his presentation, and kudos to him. He said it's a 5 to 10 year fix. It's not a 20-year solution. And Marge, you agreed with him as well. And it's not ideal, but it's better. And there was a variety of questions with regard to the kitchen and kitchen access and privacy up on the second floor. And you know, could the podiatrist work with the Board of Health? And none of that seemed to be feasible. But you know, it's imperative that this project be done well so that more people will utilize it. Okay, fair enough.
All right, next question. What would you do about the contaminated water wells? Back to Joan.
This is a topic. It concerned me, quite frankly. The last time I remember being at town meeting, it was reported to us that there were two wells that were not functional because of the water resource at that point was not appropriate, so it was considered contaminated, and they were shut. And then about a month ago or so, John Sanchez was on Burlington and Beyond, and he indicated at that point that we're not two, but in fact three wells shut down. We have a total of 7 wells here in this town. It's unfortunate that it's not being brought to the forefront presently by different boards within the town, and it's not being brought to the forefront of the citizens' attention via the Board of Selectmen. As your Board of Selectmen, it's imperative for my purposes that you and I, all of us, have appropriate drinking water. And the question becomes, where are we going to get our water if we can't use our own wells? Certainly, Mill Pond Reservoir is a resource, and we've had a very good winter. Fortunately, there's been a lot of precipitation in terms of snow and rain, so it's full right now. But as I stand here today, how many of you know whether or not Burlington has a water ban in effect? Show of hands. Okay. We're about 40%. Yes, we still do have a water ban. We're not feeling it because we're not trying to water our vegetable patch. We're not trying to wash our cars. Yet there's a permanent water ban in this town. We need to start thinking honestly and globally and rapidly about this issue. Some people have opined about going into the MWRA. That is an option. It's an expensive option. The sooner we can get our 3 wells functioning, or even bring one back online and then a second and a third, would be much better for the town's resources. Because at the end of the day, if we hook up to the MWRA, we are at, you know, we are at their mercy to some degree with regard to our water bills. And these are the kind of costs that they hurt seniors. So water is imperative. It's going to be a fundamental thing that I solve when I'm a selectman. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. As I stated in 2 prior debates, I will make water my number one priority with regards to infrastructure. I sat with John Sanchez for an extended amount of time, and he explained to me that it's not the water volume that's the issue, it is the ability of the 2 reservoirs, the Mill Pond and the Vine Brook, to produce enough gallonage, I guess you could call it, per day to supply the residents. So it's not the volume, so even if we have a big snowstorm, a big rainstorm, that won't solve this problem. It's the ability to produce clean water. There is 1,4-dioxin in the wells that are contaminated, and there hasn't been much discussion about remediation. There has been talk about tapping in and having the MWRA supplement our water. So I don't have that answer yet. I'll defer to the professionals on the water end as far as getting the answer. But that is going to definitely be my number one priority. I've stated it before, I'm stating it again today. Water is key, it affects everybody in this town.
All right, thank you. We have another question on the same sort of topic. Why do the selectmen allow use of well water to sprinkle or water lawns? The well water they use comes from the area related to the town well water. So I think this is in regards to people who have private wells being able to not be part of the watering ban. And we go to Jim first.
Well, that was a decision that the Board of Selectmen made. I don't know what their reasoning was or why. That was their decision. Again, I will defer to the water experts why well water is okay and why well water isn't. I don't have that answer why well water is okay. I just don't, I'm not going to fool you. I don't have that answer right here, right now. But if it's something that concerns residents, I'll look at it.
I'm not much help either on this topic with regard to well water, because I don't know what percentage of residents here in this town have the ability to utilize their own well water. So that's one of the things you'd want to look at first in terms of numbers. And that would be something that obviously John Sanchez from Public Works Division could assist us with regard to finding out. Probably because well water is on private property and it's a private well, that's a fundamental liberty issue. Probably people have the right to be able to utilize their own well water. I don't know that they're necessarily, you know, I don't know what how many individuals have their private well, so I don't know how much they're taking from the town source ultimately, so it's hard to say. That would be something that would have to be looked at further, because we don't know the numbers on that just yet.
Thank you. And just a quick update for everybody. This actual Monday, the Board of Selectmen did vote to lift the watering ban and make it even odd days now. So, but no one's watering the lawn yet, hopefully. Making a big ice rink in their own backyard. All right, a general question. What is the single most reason you are running for the Board of Selectmen? I'm gonna go Joan first.
I'm running for the Board of Selectmen to bring fundamental change to the town of Burlington. My concern is that there's a disconnect between what happens at town meeting and the Board of Selectmen themselves. As a town meeting member from Precinct 7, I have found that town meeting, it's a diverse group of individuals with a variety of opinions. We all express our opinions, but we're all at the end of the day respectful of one another. And at the end of the day, at town meeting, we come to some consensus with regard to what we want and envision for our town, whether it's sidewalks or it's the preservation of the landlocked forest. I was one of the 92 people at town meeting that voted to preserve the landlocked forest. To me, it is fundamental that we keep our open spaces truly open. Previously, the landlocked forest was designated general industrial use. Certain individuals in town meeting brought it to the forefront and requested that designation be changed from a general industrial use to open space. And that was very important from a town meeting perspective, because landlocked forest sits on an aquifer. That is our water source. Also, landlocked forest, it's imperative that we take the price tag off of it, because if you took an aerial view of Burlington and looked down on it, landlocked forest is looking like a very juicy piece of property to develop. And in fact, Patriot Partners several years ago attempted to do that, and then they realized the cost of running utility lines, et cetera, into there, and also a road would be cost prohibitive. But you do not want, which is why I was pleased that we voted 92-11 to take the price tag off of the landlocked forest and keep it designated open space. I was not pleased with regard to the Board of Selectmen's comments upon this, that it was arrogant and selfish. If you look at the mission statement for the Board of Selectmen, one of the fundamental tasks, I think it's the first task, is that they preserve the appropriate land here in the town. The landlocked forest is the land of the citizens, the residents of Burlington. It's all our land. Thank you.
Thank you. I touched upon it in my opening statement. To me, it seems natural. I've been given back to this town that's given me so much. This town has given me a place to raise my family. Okay, I graduated Burlington High. My kids graduated Burlington High. It's a great town. It's been good to me. I want to be good to Burlington. I started, as I said, when my kids were little, over at Pine Glen. I was in the PTO, became PTO president. I've served on two school councils, Rotary. I've been involved in numerous activities in town. Truck Day, Celebrate Burlington. I organized all those national night outs we had down at Shaw's and Wegmans and events like that. The Spooktacular that's very successful in fall. I'm a co-founder of that. I love this town. I want to continue to do stuff for this town. I feel it's in me to be selectman. It's just my next natural step.
Great, thank you both. All right, Burlington tax rates have increased significantly, more than the cost of living, over the past 10 years. what will you do about this?
Thank you, Rich. The question asked is, the tax rates have continued to rise. Please, that's not true. Tax rates have been falling. They've fallen twice since 2014. They're at 11.06 per thousand right now, the lowest we've had in years. That's the tax rate. Taxes are going up. Your house value is going up. That's not a bad thing. My house value is going up. Everybody who owns a house in Burlington, your taxes are going up because of your house value. The tax rate, and it's all public information, the tax rate has been going down. So this talk about tax rates going up, it just doesn't make sense.
With regard to the tax rates, it was 9% for several years, and then it's been dancing around at 11%. The concern here is, yes, for many seniors, you are actually house rich and often sometimes cash poor. And the concern here is that although the tax rate in the last 2 years has gone down, overall it continues to rise. And, you know, it's been bandied about to some degree that, well, the taxes are only going to go up about $98 for someone that has a home value of $400,000 or $500,000. And at first blush, that may sound reasonable, but if it's $90 or $100 over 5 years, that's $500. And for a lot of seniors on a limited income that don't have any other revenue sources, this is a difficult decision for them. Because at some point, they have to make a very, very heart-wrenching decision. Do they leave Burlington? I want the people that are seniors in this town to remain in this town. That's part of the public trust that I think, and the respect we need to show our elders. And I'm sure Jim is equally respectful of his elders, particularly his mom. But the point is that we need to be able to make sure that all seniors in Burlington can remain in their homes to the extent that they want to. And if they need a different type of housing, that we are able to offer that to them. And so while the tax rate has gone down for the last 2 years, incrementally it keeps going up. And again, the other thing you have to watch is your water rates. If we do hook up to the MWRA, your water rates are going to go up. So it becomes almost a fiscal shell game that's being played. And to some degree, it's against the seniors. I mean, I'm very fortunate. My husband and I both work, and we have two incomes coming into the house. And I think Jim is in a similar situation. But for people who are on limited incomes, this is a problem. And I don't want to push seniors out of their houses. We, as a community, can do better. And we, as a community, will do better.
And the next question is somewhat related to taxes, so I might be able to fit in a response. If you're elected as selectman and work to lower taxes, what programs would you look to cut? I guess, I mean, if any.
None. People in this town love what they get. They love the amenities. They get a lot of bang for their buck. Look at the towns around us. Trash fees, school fees, user fees. All those, we don't have those. Okay, we don't have those fees. We have it really good here. We have one of the lowest tax rates around. I personally can't remember the last time it's been in the nines. I don't know if you can, but I can't remember when it's been in the nines. So I am not going to cut, I shouldn't say that. I am not looking at cutting anything, not only because everybody loves what they're getting right now. People enjoy living in town right now. I right now don't see any need for cuts. If tax revenue was cut, then of course we'd have to make cuts. I don't know where we'd start. It would affect everyone in this room. It would affect everybody in town if we started cutting.
I hear this refrain very often. I hear it at town meeting. The first question, if you actually have the audacity to question anything with regard to the town budget or any singular line within the town budget, the first thing that you'll hear from the town administrator and other individuals at town meeting is, what services would you like to cut? Like my opponent, I do not intend to cut services. What I do intend to do as a selectman, and what I am doing right now on town meeting and on Ways and Means and looking at the school department budget, is making sure that your tax dollars are spent prudently. We all have incomes. We all have to make sure that our dollars go as far as they possibly can. And sometimes it's one of those things of just looking at a problem on a more global level and finding a way that may not even cost money. Like for traffic mitigation, turning to our corporate office partners and asking them to stagger their workers in and out of town is not a bad idea. If you drive by Microsoft on South Bedford or Nuance at 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock on a Friday night, you will see that parking lot about a fifth full. You will see multiple offices and cubicles lit up. And inside those offices, it's not just people doing maintenance work. It's actually workers doing work because they are multinational. That's one of those win-win solutions that we can do as residents that will not affect our tax rate or our services and also makes life more pleasant for us. Let's think on a visionary basis. Let's think more globally. Let's be good partners with the corporations in our town, and let's put our residents first. That's what I intend to do as your next selectman.
All right, thank you. All right. Trying to see if we can stay on any themes, but it doesn't look like it at this point. All right. Another general question, if it is a question. It is time for a real change in Burlington, from a town government to something else. Do you agree? I think the question is floating the idea is it time for Burlington to look at maybe a city, sort of city council type government? Is that the questioner's intent? I know.
I
just
spoke them out.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, please help and ask that question again.
All right. It is time for a real change in Burlington, from a town government to something else, possibly city council. Do you agree?
Well, I will tell you. January 31st, I had a very interesting evening. In the morning, I went and conducted a training at DOC headquarters, and in the afternoon, I was back at my office in Boston. I work in the city of Boston, and sometimes I'm out at a state prison at MCI Concord doing research or getting ready for a trial. So I'm a local girl very much through and through. But the evening of January 31st, it was my 53rd birthday. And what I did on the evening of my 53rd birthday was sit and watch the Board of Selectmen vetting their legal counsel. And it was interesting. I spent 2.5 hours taking copious notes. If you watch me at anything, today is like the only day I'm not taking notes. But my nature is to take copious notes. And one of the questions that seemed to be percolating from the selectmen, the five selectmen, was the question to the council that they were vetting whether or not what they would do with an illegal motion from town meeting, which I thought was peculiar, and what experience they had with cities and with mayors. And that concerned me. I think the process that we have here right now with 126 citizens who are vested in the process of being in town meeting is, it's not a perfect system. It's a little bit of sausage making. It requires diplomacy and patience. And I don't have a lorry load of patience myself, so I understand it sometimes. But at the end of the day, town meeting is a wonderful, viable process, and we do come to some good consensus. And the Board of Selectmen is the equivalent of a mayor. I think what we have right now is well and good, and I'd like us to continue with the Board of Selectmen and not switch to a city and not switch to a mayor. Because then I want you to think for yourselves, who do you think is going to run for mayor in this town? I leave that question to you.
Thank you. Burlington has been a town since 1799. My answer to that is it should not be anything else. It's been the town of Burlington. It is the town of Burlington. We're the town of Burlington. And as far as I'm concerned, whatever I can do, I'll make sure it stays the town of Burlington.
All right. Next question, which I know both candidates love because I asked it to them at our debate. How do we go about limiting availability of recreational marijuana? Again.
Well, as you've seen in the news, it's as far as the availability through medical marijuana is one thing, but the availability through retail sales is another. That retail sales portion, selling of marijuana, still hasn't been answered. The state has not, they just pushed back the release, or whatever you want to call it, to 2018. It's not going to be allowed in 2018. The state can't figure it out. Okay, and it's their law. We have to abide by their law, first of all. So once they get it figured out, being a state law, we have to craft certain things to make it work for our benefit. We can't change the law, we can't reverse it, but we can work on things as far as making zoning, certain zoning areas where it can be distributed, and issues like that. But to give a black and white answer on a gray question, you're just not going to get that until the law is finalized, which it isn't. So once it's finalized, then we can revisit it. But right now, to give a firm answer on such an unanswered question, it's impossible.
No, I haven't answered it yet.
I'm not fond of this question any more than Sergeant Tigas. Obviously, from the Department of Correction perspective, if you ask me, I know 10,500 people with polysubstance abuse problems, and I call them inmates. So I'm not particularly fond of recreational marijuana. I understand medical marijuana for people that need it, that have chemotherapy issues. Recreational marijuana concerns me. I'm a wife, I'm a mother. My sons are grown at this point. They're 23 and 26. Yet if I had younger children, I'd be somewhat concerned about that. Jim and I are in agreement. The state is all over the board with regard to this. The state law was passed, and then the Attorney General has put a moratorium in effect, essentially, with regard to medical marijuana dispensaries. And of course, we have to think, okay, Burlington, we have Route 3A, we have Route 3, we have Route 128. We have many, many avenues here in town, and people, if medical marijuana dispensaries come into play here, are probably going to come to town just to purchase marijuana, among other things, and a lot of the corporations, their workers will probably come in and purchase it as well. What can we do from a zoning perspective? Certainly you can keep it away from places where children congregate, and that's it's imperative for us to do that, and I'm sure Jim would agree with me with regard to that. And that's with regard to where children recreate, or where they they can be, which could be as simple as a dance studio or a YMCA or any place where children are. You can keep a dispensary away within 1,000 feet. And so we have to double check our measurements and such in order to control it to some degree. Right now, it is in disarray. The federal government is very behind. Some of the states have passed it. Massachusetts has passed it, but the implementation has been held off by the Attorney General's office. So it is in flux right now. That doesn't mean as a selectman you can't start thinking about the process, and I'm sure Jim and I are both doing that, as to how we plan for the future with regard to that, because I do have concerns. This is a place with a lot of highway access and a lot of corporate employees that might take a shine to that.
All right. Everybody wants to know about the marijuana. All right, a couple more here. Do you support a moratorium on redevelopment? We'll go to Joan first.
Do I support a moratorium on redevelopment? No. Would you like me to elaborate? That is the point. No, I don't support a moratorium on redevelopment. Most of the development that isn't done in this town is redevelopment, because this precious few lots that are available for full development. And obviously, the price tag has been taken off of landlocked forest, so that's not going to be developed, and that would be virgin territory otherwise. But I don't believe a moratorium is appropriate or effective. I think what we need to do is, at the Board of Selectmen level, needs to be a good corporate partner with regard. We need to reach out to the corporations that are planning on doing business here and that are planning on siting here, and make sure that what they do is appropriate for the residents here in the town. There's certain places where corporations in the past have thought to site. Dave and Buster's wanted to be on Middlesex Turnpike. Horrifying, horrifying, I know. You think the traffic is fun now. You can only imagine. So it's one of those things. We need to obviously be proactive with regard to them and where they plan on rehabilitating properties, and make sure that what we do is in the best interest of the residents and the corporation itself, so that it stays here. We don't want to have corporate gypsies here. We've had iRobot. They were incentivized to come here. They went to Route 3. They're now down in Bedford. We need to do better. We can do better. We will do better.
Thank you. Again, with regards to redevelopment, I am not for a moratorium on redevelopment, because if we had one, what would we have done with Building 19? It would have stayed the way it was. That's why you can't, pardon the term, handcuff yourself with a moratorium. So I am in favor of redevelopment. New development, maybe not, but definitely in favor of redevelopment. When we redevelop an area, we are taking contaminants out of town. We're taking Freon that they used in the air conditioning systems. We're taking lead paint out. We're taking asphalt shingles. We're taking asbestos out of Burlington. It's gone. What's replacing it? Every building that gets taken down, all the old high water use toilets, sink, showers, those get taken out, and new water efficient appliances are put in, new toilets, sinks. So that is helping with our water as well, by replacing all these older fixtures with the new water efficient fixtures. So again, that's a redevelopment thing. What I like about our redevelopment is they seem to be creating walkable redevelopment, like the district. I use that as an example. If you work in the district, you can walk to lunch, you can walk to the mall, you can walk up the street to your doctor's appointment. It's walkable. That's key, because it keeps traffic off the road. So no, I'm not in favor of a full moratorium on redevelopment.
All right, thank you. All right, I got a couple questions left. We had a little issue or discussion with one of them. I'm gonna try to word it as impartially as possible. So I would say, how would you stay impartial and transparent in discussions or decisions regarding town employee insurance, retirement, and contract negotiations? We'll go to Jim first.
I'm sure that question was asked aimed toward me. I've been unbiased for 30 years. When I do my job, I have to be neutral, impartial, and detached. I've got a lot of practice at doing that. I will continue to do that. There are boards in this town, all of them, that have abstentions. Every board in this town, there are people who abstain for one reason or another. If it's an issue that affects me, I've said I would abstain. An issue that was brought up was the police contract. Number one, selectmen do not negotiate labor contracts. The town administrator, human resources, and the department head do. Selectmen do not negotiate. And the body that has the final say on contracts is town meeting. I know that. I hope my opponent knows that. Selectmen do not negotiate contracts. Town meeting has the final say. As far as the police contract, as well as other contracts in town, they're on a 3-year cycle. So that means since 1998, there have been 6 police contracts ratified. So if your question is, do 6 contracts that I don't negotiate in, that I don't participate in negotiations, over 19 years as a conflict, then that's your conflict, not mine, and not the town's.
With regard to the policeman's contracts, there's not one but 2 policeman's contracts that are being negotiated. With regard to the Board of Selectmen's role in that, the Board of Selectmen go into executive session. They direct John Petron, the town administrator, with regard to the contracts. So initially, when we get to the town meeting level, what you see is the Board of Selectmen opining their opinion with regard to a contract. You have feedback also provided or an input provided by Ways and Means, and then finally it is voted on town meeting. But with regard to the Board of Selectmen, they go into executive session, just like the school committee goes into executive session to talk about the collecting of bargaining agreements for teachers. How would I stay transparent? How would I be impartial and transparent with regard to collective bargaining agreements? Basically, I plan on taking input from the community in a variety of ways. I plan on having monthly meetings here at the Council on Aging. I plan on having monthly meetings at the Burlington Public Library and also a monthly meeting at a coffee shop. I want people to be able to come and speak to me directly with regard to any concerns they have, with regard to any collective bargaining agreements or any other matter in this town. Some people will email me, some people will Facebook me, some people will not be comfortable doing either of that. They will want to have a face-to-face meeting, and I plan to be available for people. I am conflict-free. I work for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. There is nothing that will cross my desk as a selectman that's going to affect my judgment one way or another. And I am, my concern with the Board of Selectmen currently is, Mike Runyon is a noble individual. He runs into buildings where I run away, let's be honest. He's a firefighter. But we have a firefighter that's a Board of Selectmen member, Jim Tigges, who is hoping to be a Board of Selectmen member, who's a police officer. The two police officers' contracts for command officers and for regular officers, line officers, are both being under agreement and negotiation right now. They are not set in stone. There is an issue. Obviously, Mr. Tigges would have to abstain from those. And I suggest he abstain from the firefighters' contract as well. That's part of public safety.
All right. We have one final question from the audience, and that is, what can you do through committees to address support services such as direct care to help seniors stay in their homes?
Direct care is one of those issues that I think, obviously, the Human Resources Commission can address, and also perhaps the Board of Health to some degree. Direct care is something that is being done here at the Council on Aging to some degree. Hopefully with the renovations, there'll be better services provided with regard to that. It'll allow more access, and there's going to be more privacy afforded to people, so when they want to go upstairs and have a private discussion, they'll be able to do it and not have to worry about their neighbors overhearing their circumstances or conditions, and that's important. But direct care is something that, if that's a concern of seniors, I would find a means and a manner for addressing that. I am here to provide services. I'm a public servant. I work for a public safety agency. I've been in the field of corrections for 27 years. I'm a hard worker. I'm energetic. I'm passionate about what I do for the Commonwealth. I'm passionate about Burlington. I'd be happy to help you.
Can you rephrase that question?
What can you do through committees to address support services such as direct care to help seniors stay in their homes?
I thought the question was about staying in your homes. People are having a hard time staying in their homes for a number of reasons. They are having trouble with maintaining it. They're having trouble painting the house, cutting the grass. When I was a kid here in Burlington, we had this program called Rent-A-Kid. It was through the rec department, where they could hire kids, you know, looking for a job. It's not a full-time job or anything, but during the summer, they could help out seniors. And I did that. I painted houses, I painted rooms, I cut grasses as a kid. I'd love to see a program like that come back again. Although we'd have to work out the logistics of it, but something like that would definitely help seniors. They get the services they need, and they're not paying the contractor prices. And then the kids get a job. It benefits two sets of people. Like I said, I'm on the verge of my senior life. I'm very interested in what's going to happen over the next few years. I will work. I said I've committed myself to working with the seniors. I want this building to look good. I form committees if need be. I would ask seniors, what do you want? What committees do you want to see? I'm not there yet, but you tell me what the issues are, and I'll help you get it.
All right, thank you. And that is all the questions that we have from the audience today. So we're going to get to the final part of this debate, which is the two-minute closing statements. We're going to do the same order that we did the opening statements, which was Jim first, correct?
Thank you. Just a rebut as far as the police contract. It is not negotiations. It is an arbitration. It is out of the hands of both the union and the town at this point. So that's just a little clarification. Thank you again for the Council on Aging for hosting this event. I'm at the threshold of the next stage of my life, so senior issues are very important to me. With regards to this building, I've said it before, I want to make sure that this place stays in good shape for when it's my turn to come here. We live in a great town. It has some issues. senior housing, water, traffic. It's not perfect. But I believe that my time in town, my time serving the public, putting their lives before my own, has demonstrated how I feel about the residents. I've proven that I'm someone you can trust. My opponent has stated several times that if I'm elected to the Board of Selectmen, it would hurt the taxpayer. In fact, her campaign stated it would be extremely dangerous, in quotes, to the taxpayers. Yes, folks, me, I'd be extremely dangerous to you. That's the furthest thing from the truth. Nothing could be further from the truth. Maybe that's the way it was done in Winchester, but that's not what we do in Burlington. Burlington people don't hurt Burlington people. I'm here, I've been here, I'll always be here. So these claims about the Board of Selectmen shifting one way or the other, not while I'm there. That's not me. And I want to thank you, because the seniors have taken care of us. It's our turn. Our turn to take care of the seniors. You guys provided a home, a town for my family to be raised in. And I thank you.
I'm running for Board of Selectmen because I want to bring vision and foresight and a difference here to the town. My concern with regard to the Board of Selectmen is they are reactive instead of proactive with regard to the way they look for the future of the town and its townspeople. I'm running for the Board of Selectmen. I don't get any benefit from running from the Board of Selectmen. There's no pecuniary interest that's being served here. The salary here in this regard, it's nominal. Nobody's running for the salary. I'm here as a public servant to make a difference. I've spent 27 years in the field of corrections as an attorney. I have good skill sets with regard to negotiation and contracts. I want to work for the townspeople of Burlington. Since I've moved here 3 years ago, I've been immersed in the town with regard to town meeting. Before that, I was working full-time as an attorney and raising my sons in my prior town of Winchester. And most women understand this, whether or not you work outside the home or inside the home, at the end of the day, someone is coming home saying, "Ma, what's for dinner?" I was answering that for 20 years, you know, 25 years or so with the kids and cutting up orange slices and getting them off to soccer practice and recitals and such. But now at this point, because I have time in my life and my children are grown, my sons are 26 and 23, I have the ability to give back to the community. I have with people helping people, with the Friends of Mary Cummings Park, at town meeting, at Ways and Means. Let me take my skill set and bring it to you for the betterment of this town.
All right, I would like to thank both candidates for spending so much time answering questions with us today. And I'd like to thank Marge and everyone for organizing this part of the Selectmen's debate. And let's just give them a round of applause one more time.